Greetings, everyone, and good day. No matter where you are and what part of the world you are in, I hope that you are having a good day. I came on today to talk about my dream. I don't always talk about my dreams, but I figure let's do some dream interpretation. Or not even dream interpretation. Well, I guess it would be dream interpretation. But basically, pay attention to the lady in the red dress. There was a lady in the red dress in my dream. And I'm reminded of the Maya Angelou quote, "When somebody shows you who they are, believe them the first time." The first time. So as soon as you see any type of red flag or non-negotiable behavior, you are supposed to walk away right then and there. Walk away sooner than later. Don't wait until something else happens. Like, just, I'm going to use this as an example. You're communicating with somebody and you ask them to do something politely and they take it the wrong way. So they do it, but they do it with an attitude. And then they, let's say it's paperwork, they throw it at you, or if you're giving them something, they snatch it out your hand, or they just say something nasty and sarcastic, they mumble, like they may say, "Oh, well, you could have found a better time to ask me," or whatever, something just nasty and sarcastic. That's your clue. Now, if this is a coworker, you may not be able to avoid them totally, but you can definitely distance yourself. If it's a relative or friend, again, you can either decide to limit your contact with them, or you can go no contact at all. That will be totally up to you. But this is especially true if you have ignored the red flags and you've continued to allow this person to exhibit this same toxic behavior. And then you'll get mad and complain, but why are you getting mad and complaining when you have a choice to not deal with the person? Just because you've known somebody for a really long time, that does not obligate you to deal with them. No one is entitled to anything. For example, once your parents raise you, you're done raised. They are just the vessel to bring you into this existence. But if they are mistreating you in any way, and I'm just using parents as an example, because many people deal with this. If this person is mistreating you in any way, making you feel abused, I have a friend, one of her parents, and I should say it was both of her parents, but one of her parents has since passed away. But her parent is so manipulative, and she falls for it every time. A few years ago, she got really, really sick because of it. And I've known her for well over 10 years. And it's still the same story. It doesn't matter if the time has changed or it's a different situation or circumstance. The feeling is the same story. So she's repeating the same story. Story and say, I don't know why my parent is like that. I don't know why they do this and that. They're trying to stop me from this, that, and the other. Because your parent is jealous and envious of you, baby. Your parent doesn't want you doing what they didn't have the courage to do. Your parent doesn't want you to, you know, step out of fear and have confidence. But the ironic part is this person has other brothers and sisters, and her other brothers and sisters don't bow down to the mother like that. So I'm like, what is it within you that's making you feel like you have to be obligated and deal with this situation. Is it trauma bonding? Is it codependency? Now that, you know, would have to be explored further. And this is not me diagnosing. This is just me outside of the situation asking, why do we deal, and because I've done it too. Maybe not in the same way, but I've done it too. And then we either feel victim to it, or we learn how to rise above it. But pay attention to the lady in the red dress. And this lady could be a lady or a man. All it is symbolic of a red flag. Something that you don't have to deal with. Now, if this is a spouse and y'all been married 25, 30 years and y'all have kids, are the kids grown now? Are you employed? Are you able to move on and get your own stuff? You know, things can be replaced. Those things are not important. As long as you have your important documents and you're able to move on, and I'm not suggesting that anybody leave anybody. But at the same time, if you're being mentally, verbally, physically, or emotionally abused, why are you still there? Do you think that this person is going to change if they haven't changed in 30 years? This person's not going to change unless they get help. Now, they may get old and, you know, we know that karma sets in and, you know, they may be in a position where they're not able to do those same things to you anymore. Maybe, you know, something, one of their five senses is taken away. Or maybe more than one of their five senses is taken away. And they have no choice but to deal with this, you know, to deal with it. But what about you? Are you thinking about yourself? Or are you only thinking about that person? Or are you thinking about your family? Oh, the kids are going to be sad. Oh, my mom is going to be sad. Oh, my dad is going to be sad. Oh, my family's going to feel some kind of way. Is it really about your family? Is it? What about your peace of mind? What about your joy? Do you want to experience joy? I mean, honest, deep down joy. I remember I worked at IHOP. And it was a woman and her husband. They would come in every weekend. And I was usually their server because they liked me out of all the other servers, right? Husband wouldn't say a word. And because he wouldn't say anything, she wouldn't either have me mean look on, wouldn't even look at me half the time. Pretty much would order the same thing, so I pretty much knew what he wanted. But, you know, I would still, of course, politely take his order. And they would leave me a good tip every time. And I remember one day he was walking out before her and she came and whispered to me. He was a pastor. She came and whispered to me, he's so mean. I'm so miserable. And I was like, oh, that was like it was so heartbreaking. Then I had another, you know, older man who wasn't as pleasant. And this guy, he came in, random act of kindness. It was just so happened to be two older couples and him in the section that I was sitting in. And he said, I'm going to pay for their breakfast. So he paid for their breakfast. He ate, you know, he ordered something really simple. He, you know, ate his food and then he got up and left. So when it came time for them to pay, I said, someone has already paid for your meal. And the husband, who paid for my wife's food? Oh my goodness. Are you serious? I mean, again, some people feel obligated like, oh, well, he's just that. And people justify it and make excuses. And you know you're not happy in this situation. I don't get it. And they'll say stuff like, oh, well, you know, he always been like that. And you stayed? You're actually dealing with somebody who you can't even really have a pleasant conversation with. They just sit there with the face on all the time. Why? Do you think that's what you deserve? Do you think that's what you're worth? Do you love yourself? Do you have confidence? And in a situation like that, you probably don't have any friends. Because usually in those situations, he has to always be around. And not that there's anything wrong with that if you actually get along and you like the people that you're around. But if you stay stuck in a house and you're actually a more outgoing person, I know that you have to be miserable, like the pastor's wife. And it's like you're just going through the motions every day. And you know, you're just waiting for that person to die, hoping they die before you. And hoping that you don't get so sick from the misery that you don't go before that person. You know how many women I've heard say, I'm just ready for him to die? Like they've been in the abuse for so long and they're just so tired, 40, 50 years. And they're like, I'm just ready for him to die. That's why you see those women all snapped. I'm just saying. Because it's just so long. But if you meet someone, don't justify their behavior. Even if that's how your mother or father was. I had somebody else tell me, oh, well, my mother yelled all the time, so it's okay. No, it's not. That's not good. Especially for a female to jump up in a man's face and with all types of threats and, oh my, no, that's not good. That is not good. But people get used to what they get used to. And then, like I said, it's 10, 15, 20 years later, and they're like, what did I do? How did I get here? I've lost myself. Because you didn't pay attention to the lady in the red dress. You let the bright color excite you. You let the big button smile entice you. Or you let that print say, woo, baby, he got it going on. Come get me some of that. And you got a little bit more than you bargained for. So I just say, if you meet somebody, like I met somebody recently and he asked me for a hug and then he slid his hand down my hip. Talking about, oh, I just wanted to get a little feel. Really? Okay. Oh, you feel like some company? Nope. No thanks. You don't have to say it, me. No thank you. Nope, I'm good. Now, some woman would have put him in his place. I need to tell him about himself. For what? He knows what he did already. He did it intentionally. Or some people, some women are more, I guess, diplomatic about it. And they go, oh, you trying to fill me up already. But see, then for the guy, that could be misinterpreted as she likes it. And then there are some women who know how to say it in a very stern way. I don't appreciate you doing that and don't do it anymore. And then there are those of us that are like, listen, I don't have time. I'm not trying to figure out how to say it diplomatically. I'm not doing any of that. I'm just going to leave you alone and let you do that to somebody who want to play those type of games. Because I don't have time. And people think that I'm a pushover because I don't say anything. And that's fine. You can think whatever you choose to think about me. I could care less. What you think about me is none of my business. I choose to handle things the way that I choose to handle things. And like if this is somebody that I'm not able to distance myself from, I still distance myself from them. So I may not be able to establish physical distance, but I don't deal with you like that. And I won't deal with them. And they'd be like, oh, you want to go to lunch? Oh, no, thanks. I'm getting ready to go on this. Girl, let me go on this thing over here and get me something to eat. Oh, I just need my me time. And people know what they're doing. I don't have time to play games. I'm not getting ready to explain your bad behavior. You know what you're doing. And then too, if you say something to certain people about it, different personality types, they will deny it. They will try to justify it. I don't have time for the. Listen, I'm not getting ready to deal with you trying to lie to me, trying to justify it, trying to excuse it away, because there is no excuse for bad behavior. But I'm not mad. I still love you. I love you. And I send you love and light. And I wish the best for you. We're just on different levels. And it's okay. It's okay. Because you're doing things the way you choose to do them. And I'm doing things the way that I choose to do them. And it is okay. We have no obligations to each other. But see, the thing about it is, people want to be around certain energies, and they will drain your energy. They will drain your energy, and they're not pouring back into you. Every relationship should have reciprocity. So if this is not a give and take relationship, whether it be a relative relationship, a romantic relationship, or a friendship relationship, if we're not pouring into each other, what are we doing? We just playing around. Just going through the motions in the name of being relatives. We just gonna deal with each other's foolishness and be okay with it. I don't think so. At least that's how I see it. We don't have to do that. We don't have to go through the motions just to say. And then don't let anyone guilt or shame you if you decide to make a decision that is beneficial to you. Because this is about your health, your peace of mind, your well-being, your self-care, your self-love. It's not about anybody else. It's about you. What did you come here to do? What is your purpose? Or some people call it a calling. What is your calling? Is staying stuck in this situation preventing you from pursuing your calling? Because you know you're supposed to be doing something else. And every day you make an excuse. You're not doing it. Why? Oh, well, I got to do this for my dad, or my cousin want me to go get something to eat with them. Is that helping your calling? Or is it okay if you say, not today? And you actually sit your booty down and write and sing and record it and sew and crochet and do hair. I don't know. Write a business plan. start investing in the stock market, whatever it is. I don't know what that dream is for you. I don't know what you've always been wanting to do, but I know that you've been avoiding it. I know that you've been allowing people, places, and things to distract you from it. I know that. I know you get mad if somebody says something to you about it, because you don't want nobody to say anything to you, because you know you dropped the ball. And so you don't want to be accountable or responsible for dropping the ball. So if somebody says something to you about it or tries to motivate or push you, you get mad at that person. And then you think about it, and you'll come back around to it like, I know that that person was right. You may or may not tell that person they were right. You may just take action. You may write that book that you've been wanting to write. You may finish making that blanket that you started. You may go to the museum you've always been wanting to. You may go to the aquarium, take your relatives, or just go by yourself. You may go hike up that mountain that you've been wanting to hike up for a really long time. I don't know what it is. You do. So do it. And stop paying attention to the lady in the red dress. Stop allowing her to distract you, honey. Learn from it. Learn from all the situations in your past. Anything that you feel like, I've done this since I was a teenager. Any relationship that I only did it with relationships at that time. If I was in a relationship and it ended, I would say, okay, what did I learn from this situation? And I would spend at least a year single to allow myself to figure out what I learned, where I went wrong, which was just about every time, ignoring the red flags and non-negotiable behaviors. Paying attention to the lady in the red dress instead of saying, oh, hey, Miss Lady, how you doing? All right, now, take care then. Because that's what I was supposed to do. Because usually there are always red flags. There's always some type of clue or hint, I should say. I didn't mean to say red flag. You usually get some type of hint or clue. Like I said, if you ask someone to do something and you hand them a paper and you... can you help me do so-and-so and such and such? And in their mind, oh, I don't want nobody to tell me what to do. And again, they don't comprehend the difference between asking and telling. So they immediately get an attitude. And they snatch the paper out your hand. Or snatch whatever it is out your hand. That's a clue. And the same person might, you know, just to butter you up, because a lot of times people will do what they need to do for a period of time. Let's say 6 months to a year. But people can only pretend but so long. But within that time frame, you usually see some type of clue. It's usually not just smooth sailing the whole time. There's usually some indication that something might be a little off or could go awry. And I know one of my biggest lessons is I stayed in certain situations way longer than I should have. That was usually what I did wrong. Or I shouldn't have accepted that person in my life at all to begin with. Because I knew. But sometimes we don't want to be alone. Or, you know, sometimes they'll say or do something to make us say, oh, well, I'll give this person a chance. Maybe they've changed. But if a person hasn't gotten any help or something tragic hasn't happened in their life, 99.999999% of the time, they are still the same person. And nine, it is completion. So you need to complete them out your life. I love y'all, and I do wish the best for you, whatever you decide to do, because I know some people aren't able to just change their situation, but you can have a strategy to exit, even if you know it might take you some time to exit. So if that means, you go to work, you save $50, $100 for the next year or 2 years, and then you're able to move on, then that's what you should do. If you just say, you know what, I'm going to set clear boundaries and I'm not going to deal with this anymore. Cousin, we're not going to be able to go out to dinner. Maybe I'll be able to go out to dinner with you in March or April. Now, these people that you're changing around, they're not going to like it. But is this about you or them? Are you worried about what they think? Or are you concerned more about your health and your peace of mind? Your mental health and your peace of mind. What's more important? Doing what they want you to do when they want you to do it so they won't get mad. Or doing what you need to do to be the best version of yourself. So if you just want to go to the beach and you want to go by yourself and everybody says, oh, that's stupid. Or you want to go on a cruise. I did it for my 40th birthday. I knew that I was going. I asked people if they wanted to go. They said they didn't have the money to go. And they were probably surprised because they didn't think I would go. But I knew, I said, I don't care who's going, I know I'm going. And I went. And I enjoyed myself. I met people. I'm still friends with at least two of them. And I'm looking forward to seeing them again on another vacation. Now, it's been a little while, so I haven't seen them in a while, but I just reached out to one of them recently and she said, just let me know. So it's all good. I'm ready. So, do what's best for you and live your best life and live it to the fullest. Do things to make you smile every single day. All right, y'all. That's gonna be it. Watch out for that lady in the red dress. Don't let her distract you with them bright colors like a stop sign. That's what it means. Stop. Stop in the name of love before they break your heart. Think it over. Yes. Think it over. Doom, 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 doom. All right. I'm gonna stop acting silly. But I hope this message resonated with you. And don't feel guilty for living your best life. Even if you have a Scrooge in your house that don't like it, oh boy, they're gonna do stuff to try to, they're gonna start an argument with you or make a big deal out of something that's not a big deal. So get ready. I mean, if you want to be fake around that person, but don't you want to be yourself? Don't you want to be able to just be free to be yourself? Doesn't that sound great? I think it sounds great. Okay. I'm for real this time. I'm fixing to get off of him. Please don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and tell a friend to tell a friend. Later.